PDF of the slide with the notes also available for you to get that. Okay, thank you all for coming and giving me a time to listen to me. You've got about 45 odd minutes, so we'll have a little time at the end for questions, if there are any. Were any of you at Software Testing North last year? I gave a short talk then, and I'm going to kind of go back to one or two of the ideas that came out of that. And I'm going to develop them quite a lot today. Some of the data that I'm going to be showing I got from my students who have just been finishing their final year dissertation projects, and there's a list of the names of those who contributed data to what I'm doing. So I'm looking at time series anomalies for some of the research I'm doing, and I'll be using one or two of their examples that make some rather interesting points. Now, setting the context. Yeah, I guess all of you are software testing professionals, aren't you? And I guess most of you therefore come from fairly large organisations. So you're quite familiar with the top line, which is the customers have a requirement, someone does some requirements capture for you, and then stuff happens, and out at the end of that is some code that you guys then apply some methodologies and approaches that verify and validate the code does what the spec says. Is that right? Yeah. And at the end, we deliver a system that goes into production. And these are generally the core operational systems of our organization, by and large. I have a problem. I was a systems analyst back in the mid-70s after I finished at university. And I got caught on the requirements capture. Because one of the things that comes out of the way of doing systems analysis, requirements capture, is we do not know how to capture 100% perfect requirement specification. Would you agree? That causes you an awful lot of problems, doesn't it? Particularly if it doesn't turn out until you've done your verification validation and then goes into UAT. And the users say, no, that's not what I wanted. We've all been there, haven't we? The world is now getting even more complicated because back in the old days, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the core operational systems, we knew, mostly, that our data in our systems was accurate. At least we thought we did. Today, most of the data that we're using, or a very, very large proportion of the data that we're using, is now coming from sources we have no control over. And it has magical levels of uncertainty. I'll cover that in a minute or two. So we have a major veracity problem with our operational data that we're trying to analyze and make business decisions on. We also have the problem that we are using more and more complex algorithms to make decisions. Whether it's the algorithm that sits in your little Fitbit that takes a three-axis accelerometer and attempts to identify steps and paces and stairs that you climb up and things like that, or whether it's algorithms for trying to work out what's going on in social media that's affecting your corporate perceptions. And you also have an interesting little problem coming up along the line like a steam train that will hit us all on the 25th of May 2018. GDPR. Just because it is EU legislation does not mean that we can ignore it. It will apply to us in the UK in the same way as it applies to all 200 odd countries in the world forever. just because of Brexit coming along, we will not be able to ignore GDPR. Now, many of you are, I guess, from financial services type of organisations and other sorts, and there are compliance officers somewhere in the organisation. And I know from experience, from stories I've heard, that by and large, compliance officers are ignored until the sky falls in when something goes really seriously pear-shaped. They're the people who are going to be going on about GDPR. And people are not going to listen to them until something goes badly, badly wrong. The Information Commissioner organisation is already recruiting 250 auditors at this present time to build cases against small organisations, SMEs and other organisations who are ignoring or are not compliant with GDPR principles, which I'll cover at the back end of this session. So it raises the question that here we are, in you guys, a group of people who are trying to make systems do what they are supposed to do. My thoughts for today are that you need, and I said this last year in New York, you guys need to get yourselves up the development stack to influence the requirements capture, the requirements specifications. Otherwise, you will pick these things up at the end, and we all know that fixing a problem at the end of the development timescale is stunningly expensive. So that's the context. So I'm going to go through a bit about algorithm and quite a bit about data veracity, and then I'll finish off with some of the interesting GDPR consequences that we need to be thinking about urgently. We all know that data is growing at an astonishing rate. We're doubling the amount of data just about every year now. Moore's law on steroids for data. We're in a world where more and more and more big data is coming from all over the place. And we are using that data in types of systems which we have not had before. We have systems which are learning for themselves. And you guys don't have a finger in that pie. Nobody has a finger in that pie, but humans do need to be involved. We have a problem that in many companies, although the operational systems are effectively and carefully tested by test engineers like yourselves, much of the stuff that's being done by the BI teams is never seen by you, is it? Have you, any of you, ever been involved in testing, formally testing a BI system? In the finance world, it's becoming a little bit more important. If you're in financial services, yes, the FCA is kind of enforcing rather better testing of algorithms. They don't want Knight Capital to happen again, for example. Or RBS as well, which is done because people kind of hadn't tested stuff properly and it all went very pear-shaped. But it's particularly important in the retail sector, transport, non-financial services basically, testing organisations very rarely get involved in the BI systems. The BI type systems tend not to have many formal methodologies. And we have all of these AI systems growing and growing, and predictive analytics which train themselves, select their models without human intervention, without significant testing. So an interesting context. So I want to have a little look at those four or five areas. If we're looking at big data, here are some of the IoT sort of sources of data, some of the core systems data, sources of data. Whether it's location service from a tracker, like that one on the top left, a till in the middle, corporate systems using SAP and others. Data captured off your phone, your smartphone, data captured off a Fitbit, data captured off an amazing array of gadgetry. Even trackers hanging from the necks of cows to identify when they go into estrus, because they get a bit frisky just before they go into estrus. And if you know when they start, you know which period of time to inseminate them to get male or female offspring. As wild and as weird as that. Oh, and there's also another one, apparently, a smart hairbrush. It has a little tiny microphone in it that listens to the sound as you brush your hair and tells you, as if you didn't know already, that your hair is dry or greasy. And the app on your smartphone then gives you advice. Really? 5-6 years ago, John Easton put that graph together, pointing out that this was his view by 2015, that's 2 years ago, 80% of the data we have around us is of uncertain veracity. Not that it's wrong, but we just have absolutely no idea which is right and which is wrong and by how much. Now, when I first saw that 4 years ago, I thought, ah, that's easy. That's often the enterprise data is the stuff that's accurate and all the rest is of uncertain veracity. And then I remembered my experience when I helped implement SAP back in 1999-2000. We cleansed 70% of the master data before we transferred it into SAP. And I thought, ah, now we've got clean data, it's going to stay clean for the rest of life. And then I heard, not just there, but in other companies as well, that 6, 7, 8 years on, they realised that they now have to do another data cleansing activity. It has got contaminated in the intervening 5, 6 years. So, this veracity problem affects every source of data that we have. And that has some interesting consequences. It has consequences in how we do testing. So I remember when I was a systems analyst, and we would test the data. Sometimes we would construct test data, just so that we could prove that the various logical paths were right. But then we discovered two things. The real world data is much more diverse than our constructed data. And at UAT, it was much easier to use live data, the real data, should I say, with full diversity, because we understood the data. So for example, the part number, if it was started with the letters BA, BA12345, we all knew in the industry, that particular industry, it was a bolt, a bog standard off-the-shelf bolt. And if it started with LK, it was something different. And if it started with another letter or two, it was also something different. And we all know of sort of codings built into our data like that. But if we don't have the full diversity of data, we do not necessarily know that our systems are going to work correctly or effectively. Here's some of the sources of big new data that retail particularly is getting involved with. In terms of business operations and governments, there is a view among some users of, say, Twitter or social media that I have all the data that I need to be able to understand the world around me. In statistical terms, the number in the sample set is n equals all. I've got everything, 100% of the data that I have, that I need. But if you think about Twitter, you know that with Twitter, only a tiny, tiny proportion of people actually create tweets. Most people are passive, they're followers. We know from the various hotel and rating websites that you either policy, everything is 5-star or everything is 1-star. I know a restaurant nearby where I live where he only ever gets complaints on social media. And those people have never, ever raised the problem with the management at the time the things went wrong. They do it remotely, at a distance, not quite anonymously, vitriolically. Or, as we discover with Uber, there is only one rating, both as me as a customer and you as a driver on the system. 5 stars. Have you noticed that? So you can't trust social media by and large. And N is definitely not all. N is very definitely 0.01% or thereabouts. Not enough to give a valid answer in many occasions. Location services. How many use the apps from, say, Starbucks or Costa or other organisations to receive location-based adverts of offers? Anybody? Oh. Yeah. Trouble is, a survey that's been running for two, three years now shows that 15% of all location-based adverts are targeted more than 60 miles from where the smartphone actually is. Only 15% are targeted within 100 meters of accuracy of where it is. And I've been looking at location services now with my students for the best part of 3 years. And these are various pictures that show different sorts of errors. I first tripped over the problem in Chile when I discovered a 22 kilometer error of where, from where I was. I took a photo and it was 22 kilometers out of place. The bottom two show the movement of a stationary GPS tracker at home. They do not stay stable, they go for a beautiful dance. The blue one on the bottom left is a Canon GPS tracker for a Canon camera with a decent aerial, and by and large, most of it is within about plus or minus 5 meters. In the garden, near perfect visibility. But as you can see, there's some remarkable excursions every now and then. Who's got a Fitbit tracker or an activity tracker? Anybody wearing one at the moment? Yeah. They are inaccurate. I was lent one by one of my daughters, Vivo Fit from Garmin. And ran it in parallel with my iPhone 6. 30% difference in step count. Not in distance, but step count. Now, the interesting thing is that the Vivo Smart and all the fitness trackers like that and the phones have little tiny 3-axis accelerometers, which are staggeringly sensitive. And the only way they can find out what's going on, i.e. to work out how many steps you take, or how many stairs you go up, or calculate the number of calories and so on, is by some staggeringly complicated algorithms to try and take those accelerometer readings and work out, is that a step? Is it me just waving my arm around like that? Because if you move your arm like that, you could get 1,000 steps in about 5 minutes. It's astonishing. And they keep issuing updates to the algorithms as they try and learn more and more about what you and I are doing. But there's a serious governance question, a serious issue of business ethics. 3 examples. There are 2 health companies I know of, one in the UK, one in the USA, who are offering significant discounts for your health insurance if you meet your daily, weekly activity targets. The English one penalises you £12 per week if you fail to meet your target. There's a health pet health company that offers discounts if your dog wearing a little GPS tracker or accelerometer tracker meets its daily walk its target. The only trouble is there's an experiment reported just recently. A golden Labrador retriever requiring 80 minutes of walking every day was measured, having done its 80 minutes of walking that day, had done 5 minutes. Serious penalty clause on health insurance. Third one at the bottom. Not the athletes who understand a little bit about the inaccuracy of these gadgets, but the ordinary sort of person. Look at the calories. You know, you can set your tracker to count the calories you burn. And so people will set themselves, say, 2,500 calories and manage it. And then some days they do really well, and they do 3,500 calories or 4,000 calories perhaps, and think, wow, I can reward myself now. I'm going to have a Big Mac, 1,500 calories. So what we see is actually people relying on this extraordinarily inaccurate data, and they are getting fatter, not thinner. Now, this is not entirely your area of responsibility, but from business governance, is it actually ethical to knowingly sell a device which is so inaccurate that people are getting less fit by using your device? Where you are penalising people £12 a week for failing on their tracker to meet their steps target, but on an iPhone, they easily do it. So, for example, would always want to use my iPhone step tracker because that's 30% more than my Vivo Spit does. Who else is there in your organisation who can begin to bring that message back into the whole cycle of delivering effective software? I leave that as an interesting thought, but I will come back to it. Now the next area is really, really scary and also becomes extremely critical under GDPR, the General Data Protection Regulation from the EU, which, as I say, hits us absolutely solidly next year. Machine learning. We are told all over the place machine learning is helping to make better decisions. Whether it's Amazon using machine learning to make recommendations that if other people like you bought this, or people with your profile would love to watch this Netflix film. These AI systems are interesting because we do not necessarily have any clue what they are learning. There is a beautiful example from the American military who were trying to teach vision recognition to a system to detect the difference between friendly and enemy tanks. And with the test data that they had, sorry, the training data set and the test data set, which were from the same set of data, they conclusively proved that it could distinguish between A and B. Interestingly, by accident, they discovered that vision recognition system had learned nothing whatsoever about tanks. It had learned, depending on which of the two stories you heard, it had either learned to detect the difference between forests and deserts, or between sunny skies and cloudy skies. Nothing to do with tanks. And this was alleged to be to do with tomahawks. This is kind of an interesting problem. These were based probably on neural networks, and neural networks are a very bizarre form of technology because humans cannot understand, have no means of understanding what the neural networks have actually learned. We cannot tell. And unfortunately, under GDPR, there is a very useful requirement, algorithmic transparency. If you are using AI to make decisions about things to do with individual people, you must be able to explain easily and clearly to those people affected how that algorithm has made the decision. And we cannot do that with a neural network. We cannot do that effectively or easily with most predictive analytics. An interesting challenge. Those of you in the financial services areas, loan application approvals, could find this becomes interesting, particularly if you're using big data and allowing the predictive analytics to make the decisions. Have a think thereof. One of the problems clearly outlined there in that previous one was the fact that the training data set and the test data set was too limited. There's another example on the left-hand side. Face recognition. The training data set was clearly too limited and was incapable of actually recognizing a black face. It could do Caucasian faces and pale faces quite happily. It could not cope with black faces or dark faces. But then again, we know that cameras have a huge problem actually setting an exposure for black skin. Incredibly difficult. There is an interesting development both in the UK and the US where police who are processing bail applications are now using AI and machine learning to try to understand the likelihood of a particular suspect jumping bail. The American one, it turned out, although there were quite a large number of questions within the questionnaire that was used, a very large proportion of the questions were self-correlated with essentially, is the guy male and black or not? The questions themselves individually were not obviously related to that, but because of the way the demographics in the USA work, 10, 20, 30, 40 of the questions all came back to that same thing, is he black and male? If so, no bail. High risk of jumping bail. You will find the links in the notes section of the slides, which I'll post up, available to you all on my LinkedIn profile tomorrow. Who had been testing those algorithms? Not people with your background of rigorous test schedules and test data. Another area that I think you do have a direct involvement with is the GDPR principles of security and privacy by design and by default. Smart fridges have already been a problem with security in retail environments, corporate environments. Those two on the right hand side, the smart doll and the smart teddy, were there for children, for parents to buy to give to their children so they could chatter to the doll through the doll, through the internet, to the parent's smartphone. Both of those had unsecured databases on the internet which disclosed what the children were saying and contact details and so on. Both of those companies would have been taken to the cleaners in a year's time. 20 million euro fine or 4% of world GDP. That would wipe out both of those small companies on the right hand side. But you do need to be thinking very clearly about this security and privacy by design and by default. It means that when your companies, if your companies are involved, like say Cisco or others with these smart gadgets, they cannot be allowed to go live by taking out of the box, switching them on, and using the default settings. They must be guided through the choice of powerful passwords, for example. Otherwise, if there is a problem, your company will probably be at risk because you have not taken appropriate precautions to ensure that your customers not been involved with yet? Or your apps that your company has put out there, are they secure by design and by default? A critical, powerful defense if things do go wrong, if you have embedded that into your design and your implementation. I want to show a few other areas of random data. The red track has two odd anomalies at about 4 o'clock in the morning and around about 9 o'clock at night. So the guy did searches on eBay. He then thought, okay, how do I test what's going on? And he took two other days worth of profile and discovered that the nighttime kink happens every day, but didn't only happen on one day over at 4 o'clock. So this is how we begin to start thinking about time series, where we've got a lot of variability. How do we work out whether we've got an anomaly that we can ignore, or maybe it's something we need to investigate very seriously, because it might mean the system went down. But the random noise, if it's repeated every day in the same traces, okay. And it's really the problem. And I've been looking at location services for 3 years now because everybody, or a lot of people, want to use location services, GPS fixes, as a way of understanding where people are. Whether it's in criminology, or whether it's in retail, or other aspects. And it turns out GPS is not terribly accurate. Particularly with the tiny receivers, or aerials, on our Vivo Smarts, our Fitbits, and our phones. And so I got the students this year to start looking at some big sets of data to try and see what's going on. Data collected around Beijing between 2007 and 12, I think it was. And what they've done here is to try and work out from the location tracking every 5 seconds or so, things like distance, like velocity, like acceleration, like altitude, to see if we can identify, at least in the time series, points where clearly the GPS receiver has had a problem. And what we can see on the top left-hand side is very, very bouncy data, but going up to about, 10, 20 miles an hour perhaps. So we've got two lots, really, of movement. And if you compare that middle section, which is higher, and then look across to the right-hand side, the orangey track is down the motorway in Beijing. Whereas the rest is very much, as you can see with the blue track, a dark blue track, around from the left-hand side around the right-hand edge and so on, is on obviously on roads which are much more clogged up, so there's speeds changing all the time. The bottom one here, I can't see it there. The bottom one is an interesting one, I'll come back to it in a minute. The altitude is kind of interesting, again, very, very uncertain. Let's have a look at the acceleration. What this is showing is in the middle on the motorway, very, very consistent speeds. All the rest, violent peaks, violent spiking, where, for whatever reason, the speeds are changing dramatically all the time. Now, I haven't gone into this one particularly yet, but looking at some of them, it's quite clear that the velocity changes are completely infeasible for a car. You know, half a G plus is not likely to happen. Not unless you drive very, very meteorically with a very powerful car. What we also see is a lot of them are directly related, a very high positive and then a very high negative. So a very great acceleration, very great deceleration, which are very clearly anomalies. So in a time series, we can detect some of the problem areas. You see, this has consequences for if you have a black box in the boot of your car that monitors your driving style. If it only relies upon GPS, for the sake of argument, then that sort of trace, if you believed it, would say, hey, this driver is horrendous. Get him off our insurance books as quickly as possible. Probably, those are almost all artifacts of the errors in GPS in a car. If your black box includes an inertial accelerometer system, you probably would have iron out almost all of those spikes and get a reasonable track. So you have to understand the data that you're getting. You have to understand the reliability of the data before you go with a business exercise. And so in terms of requirements to operational systems, the testing process must begin to understand the unreliability or variability of the data that the algorithms are going to have to cope with. Diversity of data. And we see similar sort of problems here with erroneous data points. Particular ones are on the left, and then there's two in the middle, and actually one or two at the end, where quite clearly, again, serious errors in the case of tracking. The GPS has gone wrong. And it doesn't. We've got a couple of minutes left now. I want to cover GDPR quickly. Links to get some really good information from the ICO, the Information Commissioner's Office. They're producing some really brilliant documents at the moment. An observation about big data and analytics. Those five items. Lots of algorithms which are extraordinarily opaque. We do not understand necessarily what they're doing. And even if humans have created them, most people don't understand them. And high-frequency trading, as an example, in the financial services sector, is an interesting area where only the guy who actually wrote it understands it, probably. And if you think about many of the interesting derivative contracts that are produced occasionally, they are somewhat opaque as well. And there's a lovely example from the US a few years ago where the equivalent of the SCA went in to look at some of these traders, and they found that at the bottom of the out basket or the in basket were whole loads of contracts about that thick that seemed to be 6-12 months sort of old. And they found that people kept moving them from the top of the bottom and the in basket to the bottom because they couldn't understand them. I had a friend who is really quite seriously bright who spent 6 months trying to work out what a contract like that meant for derivatives. And at the end of 6 months, he came to the conclusion he had the foggiest idea what this was about. So what chance is there that you guys could test the algorithms, if they ever got computerized, about that? A bit opaque, shall we say. We do tend to collect and keep all the data. We also have a very nasty habit of, we've got this data that was for that, but we could use it for that. If that has been collected from humans under one disclosure, we will not be allowed to use it and repurpose it for something else without getting permission from the user itself who signed up for it. And we get lots of new data as well. Many of these things have very intrusive effects. And how many of you remember the case of Target in the States, pregnancy forecasting? Just a little bit intrusive, which is why the father went to shout at the manager before he realised that his daughter had actually told him she was pregnant because she had got around to him. Three interesting thoughts from the GDPR as identified by the ICO about fairness in the use manipulation of our data. One of the things about GDPR is it makes the point very clear that all of the data about me or about you is now owned clearly by me or you. It puts to bed the debate that's been going on in the transport sector for 5 years now about who owns the data collected in those black boxes in the back of a car? Is it me, the owner of the car, or you, the driver of the car at the time, or is it the manufacturer who put it in there because, like BMW, they want to find out how we drive their cars, or is it the insurance company who put it there? Now, very, very clear. The debate essentially is closed. But it has consequences on our system designs. Profiling and AI type of technologies that is used for making decisions by corporations and businesses about how they should deal with us. Now, this is one that you will need to start getting your test systems working real fast. The consequences of a right to be forgotten and the right to withdraw your consent for a company to hold your data, whether it's Tesco, or Marks & Sparks with their Sparks cards. We have all ticked the box, possibly, to agree for them to collect our data and to use that data for various purposes. As of the 25th of May 2018, those companies will have to have in place mechanisms that will delete the data across the entire platform when I decide to uncheck that box that I checked a year ago. Had you thought that you would need to be testing that, folks? Because you're going to need to be able to do that. To delete all that data completely. Not to use it at all. Not to share it across to other organisations, which you probably share everybody else's data. Some interesting consequences, folks. Then there are a few slides here, which you can actually see there, about various aspects. Auditing. You need to have some really interesting auditing built in. I think the most important one, well, the really important one, is the security. Privacy by design and by default. Closing consequences. I think one of the most important aspects is going to be proving security and privacy by design and default. A point is that data cleansing, which the data analytics or big data analytics profession is ever so keen on, it isn't going to succeed with all this data pouring out of the IoT because the equipment is just not going to deliver good data. We cannot cleanse the data very well. We have to understand the patterns and understand what that does to our decision-making processes. Transparency of algorithms, the AI type algorithms, critical. Is there a place that you guys, you professionals, the testing professional, can actually help your organizations to be successful in developing algorithms for decision advice rather than maybe decision making? We know from 40 years' experience, computers are very bad at making decisions, they're very good at crunching numbers to give recommendations. And that last one, the right to be forgotten and to withdraw your consent. How are you going to get involved in ensuring the requirement specifications include that and that then it is tested to be absolutely certain across the entire data estate? Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, it would open up a very exciting can of worms, actually.
And that's a very important point as well. If you acquired bought data from someone who collected it with consent, is there an implication in GDPR of a chain of consent, and therefore chain of withdrawal of consent?
Because I'm thinking, like, in my area, particular financial crime, right? And anything around financial crime, anti-money laundering, you know, politically exposed people, whatever, right? We obviously depend on numerous different data sources and data mining to pull that picture together. So I'm just trying to get my head around this topic in relation to that.
Yeah, I think, I mean, that's going to be an interesting question. Data that organisations have collected in the course of business with consent, as compared to some of the stuff that you're probably doing, which you're collecting from public sources.
Yeah.
And there's kind of an interesting debate going on about, you know, is my LinkedIn profile private or public? So if you are scraping out LinkedIn, maybe that is not covered exactly in the same way. I'm not sure what the position there is. I suspect the lawyers are going to have a lot of fun over this one.
My understanding of GDPR is there's two types of data, there's SPI and PII. So as long as I'm masking if I was using SPI, special personal information, or PII, personally identified information, as long as I'm masking that data, those elements that are within my database, then I'm not falling foul of GDPR?
The question, I mean, one of the things that's going to be very interesting, because it really, in many respects, is personal identifiable information and the sensitive information, which is the health type of stuff. But remember, even things like my own personal IP address or the MAC address of your mobile phone is now personal information such as GDPR. If you do masking or you are encrypting, storing encrypted data, then, because all this is all about loss of data, ultimately, whether it's been hacked and extracted, if it's in normal stuff, not the rightly forgotten stuff, but the real point about GDPR is to protect our data so that hackers can't use it for unauthorized purposes. And if you're storing data encrypted, and if you're actually using the type of encryption where you can actually process the data without decrypting it and still get valid results, then, you know, you're kind of protected nicely. So from that perspective, whether PPI or the SPI or PSI, it's really just saying it's actually two sorts, and they are all together, really need to be kept secure and private by design and by default. If you've done that design and by default, and somehow, in spite of everything that you've done, and you've kept all your patches up to date, and still we're getting and extract all the data, you've got a pretty darn good defence abroad. You probably won't get it done for €20 million or 4% of turnover. So it's really to do the very best endeavours we possibly can to keep that data secure and private. The problem with, and if you go back to that cane and the dog, the problem there was they hadn't done a thing to keep it private. They hadn't done a thing to keep it secure.
Did you have, was it 72 hours to report data breach?
72 or 24, yes. It doesn't matter. The point is, as soon as you recognise it, the idea is not that you've got to do it within a time period of when it actually happened, but when you discover it. And there's actually been a complication, because if I had a piece of paper with a whole lot of names of people on it, say in the attending list here, and I showed it like that, that's a breach in itself. And so it's not meaning every possible breach, but the significant ones. Any more questions? Okay.
Right, okay.